sometimes how God brings you through so much, and you've been through everything, that when something comes to shake up somebody's world, so to speak, yeah, you just look at it like, okay, well, I'm sorry you're upset. I'm sorry you're worried. It's kind of a shame that, you know, you're all panicking. But, you know, at some point in time, you really have to live like a believer. I mean, you know, you can freak out every time that you get a hangnail. I mean, you can either react or learn to trust that God loves you and cares for you, and that if you die, you'll go to be with Him. If you don't die, you're going to make it through. Pretty simple. He takes care of you. Right? The reality of knowing God is the assurance that He will do these things that He's promised to do. And that's why we are the ones that are called the light of the world. We're put here for a purpose. There's a reason why we're here. And so whenever there's a storm or an earthquake or a tsunami or a typhoon or a windstorm or a hangnail or, you know, cancer or whatever the circumstances may be, the reality of having Jesus with us is that we can turn to Him and ask Him, you know, whether it's something we should really worry about, although I don't can't imagine worrying at all, but whether it's that important or whether we should be the ones to encourage others to move on and to trust in Him with all their heart, lean not in their own understanding, in all their ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct their path. Because people will panic, and people will fear, and people will do crazy things with their emotions, but your devotion that you have with God will always show in how you control your emotion, and how your the fruit of the Spirit in you will be revealed through the circumstances around you, as you show forth the peace, the love, the joy that you have in God. I mean, He's got your back, and He's got your front, and He's got your insides, and He's got your outsides. And He's got you all through the sides. So all you have to do is abide. So in Spurgeon today, the voice of weeping shall be no more heard, in Isaiah. The glorified weep no more, for all outward causes of grief are gone. There are no broken friendships, nor blighted prospects in heaven. Poverty, famine, peril, persecution, and slander, all are unknown there. No pain distresses, no thought of death or bereavement saddens. They weep no more, for they are perfectly sanctified. No evil heart of unbelief prompts them to depart from the living God. They are without fault before His throne, and are fully conformed to His image. Well may they cease to mourn who have ceased to sin. They weep no more because all fear of change is past. They know that they are eternally secure. Sin is shut out, and they are shut in. They dwell within a city which shall never be stormed. They bask in a sun which shall never set. They drink of a river which shall never dry. They pluck fruit from a tree which shall never wither. Countless cycles may revolve, but eternity shall not be exhausted, and while eternity endures, their immortality and blessedness shall coexist with it. They are forever with the Lord. They weep no more because every desire is fulfilled. They cannot wish for anything which they have not in possession. Eye and ear, heart and hand, judgment, imagination, hope, desire, will, all the faculties are completely satisfied. And imperfect as our present ideas are of the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him, yet we know enough by the revelation of the Spirit that the saints above are supremely blessed. The joy of Christ, which is an infinite fullness of delight, is in them. They bathe themselves in the bottomless, shoreless sea of infinite beatitude. That same joyful rest remains for us. It may not be far distant. Ere long the weeping willow shall be exchanged for the palm branch of victory, and sorrow's dewdrops will be transformed into the pearls of everlasting bliss. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. And in poetic redress, as Spurgeon often does, we find ourselves aware of something beyond compare to what we experience now, that there is a place we're going home to, and that is our home, where we shall be satisfied. And if you think of everything in your life, of anything, no matter what it is, put the word satisfied there, and that'll begin to give you an idea of why we don't want to be here much longer and why we're looking forward to going finally home.